Yep. Oh yeah. Monster. Big bass. Look at this guy. Holy cow. I'd say. I want to show you something. Focus has been, we've been catching some fish on the overhanging trees. And you say to yourself, you want to go along the shoreline that has like pads or anything lead in. It doesn't matter. See that rock right there? You say to yourself, it's shale. It's going straight down about 5-6 feet. It does the same way underneath these trees and stuff. A lot of guys would just drive by. No way. Honestly, you have to fish everything. It's just like when you pick docks or you're fishing weed edges and things like that. Once you're committed to it, do it. Don't worry about, oh, there's rock, there's not a lot of lead and cover and stuff like that. That's a fallacy. Bass find stuff. And if it's overhanging and shade and stuff, like we're not talking 30-foot fluffs. It's only, I'm in 6 feet of water. And that drops off to about 4 feet right away. It doesn't matter. They will suspend underneath these cedar trees. And it's your job to get your bait underneath those cedar trees, shake it, and wait. Because 99% of the time when they do bite, they'll go out. They got nowhere else to go. They'll go out. You got time to reel in, set hook, catch the fish. But don't worry about those lead and cover and stuff. As long as it's overhanging and it goes back and you can't see the bottom, potentially there could be a fish. Okay, something about robbing the banks and money. What is the color of money? Green. That's it. I'm gonna keep it real simple. My jigs have green. My plastics have green. Green with a little bit of blue iridescent. And green pumpkin with black flake. That's it. Keeping it real simple. So my focus is just putting that bait in those spots, knowing that when they see either one of these or the jig, they will eat it, and I'll be making withdrawal from the bank. I'm sure this is my focus. This stuff. Overhanging trees, shade, and different things, okay? But be aware. Look what, you know, trees that have fallen in the shoreline, creeks that maybe come out, and you know, the weed growth goes out a bit farther and stuff. Work that stuff. So yeah, you're still in the bank, but it'd be crazy to ignore the things on your right hand and left hand side, depending where you're fishing. A tree going out, you know, a submerged tree, a bush, some different pads and stuff. Be aware. Fish all the stuff that's in front of you, the things that are very obvious, like the overhanging trees and stuff. But man, if you got logs and you got weeds or pads or anything that goes out and it's tapering to deep water, those are potential hot spots. Do not ignore that. So fish the trees, yes. Make your pitches and look for those ones that are in ambush spots, but never neglect these big logs that go out and taper to deeper water. I'm fishing on this, the 7.6 St. Croix Legend Xtreme, medium heavy, 20 pound gamma edge fluorocarbon on all these sticks I'm busting the bank. This one, I got little 5/16ths, 3/8ths and 1/4 ounce tungsten weights, all depending on how shallow it is or how much of a taper and shorelines I'm going to fish. Little soft plastics, some with little kicking tails. Another option, obviously, is a St. Croix Avid X 7.4 heavy action, 20 pound, obviously. And this one, same little tungsten, it's pegged, it's got more of just a flat bait. This one's called the Rodent, it doesn't have a lot of action, it just glides down. So it just gets in those spots, those fish see it, they're gonna eat it. Last but not least, when I'm breaking the bank, I have to have a jig on. 1/2 ounce and 3/8ths. I got two different colors, black with a little bit of gray and black with blue. And then I've got the copper with the green, so crayfish tones, little jig. I trim it back a little bit just to give it a little smaller profile. This has the 25 pound gamma edge fluorocarbon on my St. Croix big jig rod, because it's big bass day, robbing the banks for bass. Perfect example, hitting the trees and the weed edge. See? Under the tree. Look at that fight, hey? That fight. Okay. Turn the boat. Oh, look at that. Look at the head on that, huh? Look at the head on that. That's what happens when you fish those inside weed lines. under those trees. Look at that little bait right there. Look at the mouth on that thing. Pretty good sized fish, eh? Look at him. That's pushing some weight there, boy. Yes, sir. Let's put him in there for some pictures, huh? Oh, yeah. Nice, beautiful bass. Put that in manual. Look at him. Inside weed lines and overhanging trees. Right there. Well, what do you think of that? Hey, busting the bank with the Xtreme Bass Angler. I know you saw it before, but boy, oh boy, I cannot get enough of busting the bank in summertime when those bass are big and plentiful. Sometimes they can be a little moody, I'd say, but it doesn't matter. You got a variety of plastics in your jig, and it's all about being focused and concentrating on those trees, the logs, the pads, the fallen trees, the tapering stuff, but everything that's on the bank, coming out from the bank. You want to catch more bass? Seriously, get to the banks, make some withdrawals, kiss them, release them, and leave them for next time for somebody else to enjoy, because you know it, and you saw it right here on this show. The banks are where it's at for big bad bass. Son of a gun. Big largey too. Was a largemouth, I saw it, perfect. Well, I guess I'll, maybe they're just not on the docks, that's the thing. Look at that, 5 and 6 feet of water. Rock and weed, could be the key today. Just that rock and weed combination. I thought it was a log, but it's really a rock. And that's what he was on. Big, fat largemouth. Wow. I pulled it out and it's about a 3-pounder chasing it. It's freaky, man. Look at that. I'm working rock right there. Look at that stuff. Big, fat rocks. With my jig right here. That looks like a crayfish big time, man. Black with a silhouette, water's off color. Great combination. Give it a shot. Sometimes those big rocks hold big bass. It's not always the logs and weed and wood like people think. Largemouth go where they go. Whatever they want to eat. There's weed mixed in with this rock. That could be all they need. And they sure can see it too. Rocks and weeds. Will that be the ticket today? We'll find out. Ooh, there's some nice stuff right here. Get ready, keep it rolling. Make a nice big fat one on this stuff. The one I saw was pretty big. This is the exact same stuff. Why is one here? There's the big rock. Anybody on it? Oh yeah! Monster! Big bass. Look at this guy. Holy cow. I'd say. Here he comes. Whoa, look at that. How big is that one? Wow. There, look at that. That's a giant, giant. Look at him. Holy cow. Sitting in the rocks. Look at that thing. That's what we're looking for right there. Absolute giant in the rock and weed mixture. Oh, barely had him. Look at that. I got to show you this down there. Look at that. Look at the yap on that thing. Look at the size of that largemouth. That's a monster, man. Look at him. Oh, easy 7 pounds. Easy. You a big boy. We're going to put you in the live well. Going along, getting away from the standard stuff, the docks, the fallen trees and stuff like that. Coming out, the water's down about 3-4 feet. Let me just pull out here. There's some rocks behind us. Putting out about 7-8 feet of water, and there's just rock. I'm going to show you this in a second. You're going to freak out. It's just rock. It's nothing looking stuff. You pass over it, you think, forget it, rocks, largemouth, uh-uh. But you know what? They eat these things. You see that? That's a dark jig. And look at this. Crayfish color, stretchy little, smelly little 3X. Junk trailer, that's what he ate. That's what they're gonna eat. That was amazing. All I just went down, put it in by the big rock, shook, just felt, just he swam with it for about a foot. Whack! When I hit him, I thought, oh, how big is this thing? Then I saw him, then you saw him. Now I'm gonna show you this kind of stuff here. Take a look at this kind of stuff. 7 feet of water, rock, weed. I saw back there one about 3.5, maybe 4 pounds, miss it. I said, you know what? Here comes a big rock. We're gonna give it a shot. And I wasn't expecting a giant like that. I thought maybe a 4 pounder, 3.5. But boy, oh boy, they are here. You work them, but again, sometimes work the different stuff. Don't always run to traditional docks, trees, slot pads, etc. Come out, find the secondary cover, you can get guys like that. Think to yourself, boy, all summer I've got them deeper and edges and weed lines and crankbait and everything else. But this time of year, I'm back in stuff like that. Heavy pencil weeds, pads, grass, you name it. The stuff that you think, man, really? Are they in there? Fall? It's a time of plenty, boy. Big fish go back in the shallow water to feed. And you got to follow them. Pick your times when you're fishing it. First in the morning, it wouldn't go too shallow. I'd fish maybe 5-6 feet of water. As the sun gets up and gets warmer, get tighter, go closer, skinnier water. Those fish move. They know where they want to be. You know, you get a real cold night and the water, the shallow water, you know, it does get real cold. And sometimes it'll push them out a little bit, but not far, you know. But as soon as it warms up, that peak time, like I said, from about 10, 11 to about 3, 4 o'clock, the sun's high, those fish, you can catch them all day. But the afternoons are peak. Oh my God. Hold on, boy. Come here. Come here. Oh. Here we go. Look where you got it again, folks. Right up through there, huh? Look at that. Right up way at the back. Because the water is higher. Why is that? Because it's been raining a lot. And look at that. On Xtreme Angler, boys and girls, the fall bite. Is it big? Is it fun? You see him jump out of the water? He thinks he's a smallmouth bass. You gonna join your buddy? And we're having a fun day, man. I'm telling you, boy, when it comes together sometimes, you know, the water is so high because a lot of rain. This particular lake's got a lot of creeks and stuff. So it brings in, a couple things happen. Water rises, the temperatures go down, but it doesn't matter. You know what, we're in a fall bite. Those fish, maybe offshore, all that kind of stuff like that, they're now tight again, they want to eat. That fish was so far back that as soon as I hit him, when he turned and stuff, I thought, what is this, a whale? But he's a good one. This shallow stuff is wicked because when the fish are there, if they're big, your heart feels like it's coming out of his chest when you hit them. They turn sideways, they bang, knock against stuff. They are the alpha male. Sometimes the big females too. Oh, oh, and it's a brown's back. Look at him go, I think it is, yeah. Yeah, it's a bronze one. just knew right away when he starts to jump, flip flop and fly. He don't know when to die. Fishing in the fall is one of the best times of year to catch smallmouth in Ontario and largemouth. You know why? Because you have virtually all the spots to yourself. You heard me say it before, but I mean those docks that are just in the middle of nowhere, where you know guys usually run into them and all that kind of stuff. Most guys know where the good stuff is. But in the fall, September, October, early November, you got it to yourself. And don't kid yourself and think, again, oh, maybe it's too shallow that time of year. You know, the water gets cold. Yeah, it gets cold overnight. And early in the mornings, that wouldn't be my first choice. But come around 11 o'clock to about 3 or 4 o'clock, that's my choice. You know why? Because they go in to feed. The bluegills are there. The perch are there. All the food's there. And then they're there. So in the fall, don't be scared to go shallow in the afternoons, because that's where they are. That's where you should be. Yep. Nothing wrong with fish like that, huh? Look at him. Ready? He's coming in the boat, folks. Here he comes. That's what I like. When a plan comes together, boys. When a plan comes together, right there. Mr. Largemouth Bass on the very last little dock. You think to yourself, oh, you know, I fished them all. I fished all the good stuff. And look what's there. Another chunky fat bass. I'm going to put him in there, take a couple pictures, let him go. But we're having a fantastic day. And you know what? It's over. I've caught enough fish. I've had a good time. It's about 3 p.m. and we caught them like this. Let me put them inside there real quick. So next time you go out, late September, early October, and you know, you want to catch largemouth bass, get shallow, get big. Look how deep that is. That's why I gotta be patient with these things, man. Patience. I don't care how high the dock is. All I see is cover potential, weed, and shade. And in turn, chance for a big fish to be hiding in there. That's it. Nothing fancy. Look at that. See what I mean? See that stuff on there? Look at this. Take a close look. Take a close look. See that stuff? Brittle, beautiful green stuff. Ooh, smells like grass. That's what's under there, and that's what they'll hold to. But you gotta put your bait in there and hopefully catch them. 5 feet out here. Oh my God. Cannot rush that stuff, boy. I can only imagine leaving a fish like that. Leaving it. Pitch under there. Come back a bit. Use the whole deck of the boat. So I can feel it with the sensitive St. Croix. When I lift up, there's weed there. I can just feel it. So sensitive. Incredible rods, man. I've seen lift up sometimes and you feel a little bit of spongy weight. If you're fishing a lot of weed all the time, you'll know after a while when it's that weed or fish, then just hammer it. But if it's got a little bit of resistance, give it to it. Don't worry about setting hook and looking all weird and bait goes fly by the boat and stuff. Who cares? But if it's a big fish, it's got to find the meat and go through. Now, this isn't about finesse. It's about bigger baits for bigger bass. I'll use it like the bitsy jigs and half ounce, the big flippin jigs, but I don't want to keep the profile where they can just decide to look out, see it, and eat it. It's something that, it's not a small little finesse worm, it's not a drop shot bait, it's something that they can just eat, go back into the little hiding spot. So you wanna inspire them with the rattles, some metal flake, some color, some tone, that just gets their attention of those bigger fish in those hiding spots that you and I know are out there. A little bit smaller profile, but still a real solid hook. It won't move, it won't give. But I'm gonna show you what I do with that jig, okay? Fishing fairly open water, even with the logs and docks and that kind of stuff. I just slowly trim the weed guard just a bit. Okay, maybe two strands over. I flare it just a bit like that. But then I'll take those living rubber like that and just trim it. Trim it down. Give it a short haircut, okay? At the very back, tilt the jig like that. Get these ones a little shorter. When it's in the water, they flare out a little bit, okay? So I want the fish to hear it. And that Premier Pro has got that little rattle. just enough, not too overbearing, they just hear it. And I match that up with the smaller KVD Junior Chunk, okay? This one's like in a Bama color, Bama orange, Bama bug, whatever they call it. And I'll show you how I rig it up there, okay? I take the high part, so I want the back part, which is flat, the rest up against inside the jig between the rattle and the shaft of the hook, okay? So I'll just take it like this, put it through, put half an inch, come out, turn it, slide it up all the way, push it right up inside like that. And then when I turn it like that, look at that profile. Just a small little thing. It's got the beefy hook, a nice profile, a big meal for a fish, but not overbearing. I put this in all those spots and catch them. Consider that next time you use the jig. Now look at this dock. See this? There's a crib section there, about 10 feet long, then an open section, crib section, and you see how shallow it is. But see it tapering down here? This is the key spot, right about there. It's dark. It's in front of that crib. The fish, if they're somewhat aggressive, there's a good chance he's going to be over here. Another good spot would be at the back of this crib. You see the crib here? Right about there. If they're dormant, they sit right at the back there. They want something right on their doorstep, right on the dinner plate. And I'll still work the back as far as I can get, all the way back, like to there, the third crib. Dissect the hot spots on it, okay? And then move over here, hit the very front, where it's tapering in the water. Actually pitch it past the dock, let it pendulum right down. Lift it and drop it. You'll know if somebody's there. The clear water, murky water, you hear the rattles. Trust me, they'll eat it. It's even got weed in there, look at that stuff. See? Just a little bit of weed. Just pull it off like that, real slow, to work all the high percenter spots. Dropping it in, shaking it, and trust me, if it's got a foot of water, it can hold a 5, 6, 7, 10 pound bass, because you know what, if his back's wet, he could be in there. Never think it's too shallow, not when it comes to largemouth. Now as for color selection, here's my choice. A lot of crayfish, middle of summer, they're eating crayfish big time, so I want something to look like the crayfish, a little bit of brown and orange, etc. So there's different choices. Black and blue is standard, the brown I like in wood, green for natural tones and real clear water. This is really good and clear too, the purple and brown. But my choice for the day is a little bit of copper, gray, black, dark, you know, watermelon head, and that short shank hook. You know, I can tuck up that little junior chunk up inside there, real solid hook, but don't get overwhelmed. You know, there's tons of colors of the rainbow. Look like a Christmas tree out there when you go out in your favorite tackle store. But stick with the basic stuff, the stuff that you have in murky water, stuff in clear water, stuff in wood. And as for trailers, you just match them up. These are my junior chunks. And you can see how you can put different colors, the orange, the blue, the greens, and they just match up with the jigs that I have. I marry them up back and forth and just keep it simple. Look at that grass underneath there. Son of a gun. Look how good that looks. The jig's in all the right places. Looking for bass in all the right places. 5 feet deep out here. Oh, see that? I missed one there, boy. I got feelings of smallmouth again. Them little buggers pounce on this thing. They won't eat it. They just... I know that bite. Look at the chunk. They just pull it right down. Little buggers, man. That smallmouth. There's a big largemouth. Oh yeah, look at that. See? Put it in the right spot. Whoa. Look at you, eh? Whoa. Look at that thing. That's what I mean about putting the baits in the right spots. Busting and moving for the giants. You get off this guy's dock, taking your time, and you will get them like this by busting and moving. Go to the high potential spots with the baits that attract big bites like the jig, and you get them just like that. He's going to live well for some pictures, and then he's gonna get released like we always do. But I'm telling you, man, when you gotta bust and move, you'll find them like this on your lakes too. Go in there, big boy. That's exactly what I'm talking about. I mean, I'm moving around, go, 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 go. And I can look and see different isolated rocks and pads and things like that, but I'm gonna go to high potential areas, you know? Use the jig, go. You see me fishing, I'm fishing fast and slow. What does that mean? It's like power fishing. But what I'm doing is, when I hit the high potential spots, I dissect it, get on the trolling motor, go up again, move to the next spot. I don't worry about all the little messy stuff between. If the fish are biting slow, then I'll do that. When they're biting hard and looking for big fish, I wanna cover water with big baits, catch them big. Whew, let's go back. And this is the results of getting in and busting and moving to the hot spots on your lake, just like the lakes I fish, right there. Big mouth. Say hi to the camera, huh? Hello, hello, hello. Oh yeah. Big old brute. You ready to go, huh? Look at the big head on him. Look at him. Love it. Where's the good ones? Hey, welcome back to Extreme Angler. This week, I'm gonna answer a few more questions I get by email and stuff by viewers on fishing lakes that have largemouth bass, you know, either your cottage lake or lakes that you're visiting or lakes you like to fish. You've heard there's good largemouth bass, but it's not a lot of weed. You know, Lake Scugog and Rice Lake and all the lakes down in the US that have lots of weed, you know, Gunnersville, fantastic frog fishing and topwaters, you name it. But if there's not a lot of weed and there's good largemouth bass populations, what you gotta do is find those small little pockets of weed. Largemouth and weed go hand in hand. If there's largemouth in the lake, I guarantee you they're gonna find those little pockets, but it's your job to find them either on the edges, on drop-offs, real tight little pockets at the ends of lakes, at the beginning, near creek mouths and rivers and different things where there's some oxygen or shallower water, muddier bottom that hold those largemouth, or rock with weed around it. Trust me, when I say if you find rocks in shallower water, there's a good chance there's always gonna be a little bit of grass around it. If there's grass around it, that will attract the largemouth. So today, saw plastics, some jigs and things like that. I'm gonna put my baits in those high potential spots on the small spots looking for largemouth bass. So you can do it on those lakes you go to as well, looking for largemouth on rock-oriented lakes. Let's go get some. I wanna show you something. This tannic water, so important. Metal flake, Okeechobee craw. Actually, Okeechobee craw, the same ones like this. But the Bama bug, that watermelon with that green flake, killer, man. Let's keep these handy. Now look at this, you've seen, I think it's real thick, okay, it's real great. But it tapers from 2 feet to 3, 4, 5. If you come into areas like this and you see this weed like this, don't really be tempted to put it right in the real thick stuff in here, because look down here, it just drifts down and it goes to the deeper water. That tapering edge, that weed goes out. This would be my first spot I would try. Then I would go inside the weed. Try that tapering stuff that goes to the darker edges. Sometimes those real big guys sit on that tapering edge or right in the dark water on the very deep edge of the weed bed. If he's not there, and slowly you can work your way in, hit the thick stuff, but don't just run in there, because a lot of times you're gonna be right on top of those fish that are sitting on the edge. You know what's funny? Sometimes you say, you wanna go to lakes with lots of weed, a lot of pads and arrowheads and grass and stuff like that, where there's potential for the fish to be everywhere. But sometimes, the odd time, I'll go to lakes with the exact opposite. A little bit of weed, down trees, rock with weed, grass. You know why? Because my potential for finding those little hot spots where the fish have to go to, where they're just not gonna wander everywhere, they'll still find those spots. It actually increases my odds to catch bigger largemouth. Might sound weird, like an oxymoron. You wanna go in an area with less weeds? Yes, because if there's good populations of bigger fish, they will find those little hot spots. And you just gotta do your homework, put the trolling motor down, pull the hat down, pick up your favorite stick, and go and do it. Here we go. Look at this. Holy cow, eh? What's the size of him? Is that a big bass or what, hey? What's he got through the nose? Hey, is he hooked good? Let's see. The dog can get him here. Sometimes you gotta reach down like this and get him like that. Look at that, hey? What did I say about going into crazy little spots? Look at the size of him. Is that a giant? Is it? I'd say that's a giant. The big, beautiful fish. Easy, you. Look at the mouth on that thing. That's the kind you can catch when you go to lakes that have largemouth and smallmouth bass and not much weed cover. You find the right stuff, you find these fish. I think this fish is going for a picture, don't you? Oh yeah. He's big, he's bad. He's going in the live well, and he's gonna end up on Extreme Angler TV. I love you, big girls. You're so beautiful. Look how big you are. Yeah, you've endured to 3 and 4 pounders. But the emphasis, like I said earlier, go out, try something new, new lakes, new adventures. It'll make you a better fisherman because you'll have to adapt, not just go to the same docks and logs and rocks and all that kind of stuff and weed beds. You try new things, you broaden your horizons. You go out, you have to adapt. You have to try baits that are proven, rodent, jig, craws, different things. You do that, you're gonna catch them just like that. But please, be respectful and let them go after some pictures. I think my heart rate's almost going down a bit here. Then I will regroup and find another weed bed and hopefully another one. Like that. Whew. What happens when you go to lakes that have a little bit of weed, but you dissect it, you do your homework, and you're gonna catch them too with the proven baits. You just gotta move the right spots and catch those big fish like that right there. That's what I'm talking about right there on Extreme Angler. Real big, scary brutes all over the place on all your lakes. Hold on, you. Ready? Go on there. There he goes. So there you got it. Fish all the lakes that you like that have, you know, abundance of largemouth and or smallmouth, but find those little dissecting spots, little spots that you drive by and think, maybe. If they haven't got a lot of options, the big largemouth are gonna find it. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time on Extreme Angler TV, because the lightning's coming, storm's coming, and I gotta go. Fish hard, fish extreme, fish safe.